Today, I'm in the Kraichgau region and, as you can see, I'm standing in a quarry. Behind me, an old fracture zone in the shell limestone rock is exposed, that means visible. Such structures can result due to earthquakes, and over here, we have the opportunity to have a look at it up close. Hello and welcome. In today's video, I will be introducing to you the various types of focal mechanisms which cause earthquakes. You will learn which physical quantities describe the source of an earthquake and how they can be measured. I will first show you this using geological methods and then seismological ones. Earthquakes result when tectonic stresses are released in the rock under the earth. The simplest form of an earthquake source is when two planes slip past each other. You can see such a slip plane here in the background. The shell limestone deposits were created around approximately 240 to 250 million years ago, when this place was still a tropical ocean. Geologists have identified rock layers here that were separated by a fracture zone, as you can see back there. Such a fracture, where the original rock layers were modified by the effects of stress, is also called a fault. Here, the right section has been pushed upwards by around 4 meters compared to the left section. We call this a reverse fault. This is one of the three different types of earthquake focal mechanisms. These three types are shown in the following. Firstly, a fault like the one we saw just now in the quarry. We call this a reverse fault. In this case, a section of rock is pushed obliquely upwards relative to another section. Secondly, normal faults occur when a section of rock is pushed downwards relative to another along the fault line. The third type describes horizontal displacement of two sections of rock. These are called strike slip faults. I will show you at the fault zone down there how the movements along the fault can be described quantitatively. I'm now directly at the fault zone in front of an ancient layered ocean floor. Here we can see where the layers moved relative to each other. How exactly this movement takes place, for example during an earthquake, is generally described via three parameters. Firstly, the angle of inclination of the rupture plane to the surface, which is called the dip. Secondly, the strike. This is the orientation of the fault line between the rupture plane and the Earth's surface, that is orthogonally to the direction of inclination of the rupture plane. The third parameter indicates the slip angle of the displacement of the rock sections on the plane. First of all, I will demonstrate to you here at the fault zone itself how the three parameters are determined. After that, I will discuss the seismological methods. The first two physical quantities, dip and strike, can be measured using a compass. The fault exhibits an inclination of around 60 degrees, that is the dip. It dips towards north-northeast at 25 degrees. The strike is oriented at right angles to it, that is 25 plus 180 equals 205 degrees. The slip direction along this plane is much more difficult to quantify. Among other things, we can find stria marks on the fault plane, called lunations, which indicate the direction. You can see them on this hand specimen. However, this piece was lying on the ground. It obviously broke off from the fault. Hence, we cannot tell how it was oriented in the fault. In order to do this, geologists remove intact samples from the fault zone itself and use them for measurements. Those were the geological observations. Now I will show you how rupture planes of current earthquakes are analyzed using seismological methods. An earthquake sends out waves in all directions. The first movement impulse of the underground layers can be in an upwards or downwards direction, depending on where the wave is measured. However, the direction of the movement depends on the orientation of the rupture plane and the direction of the slip. You can see it in this diagram showing the perspective along the rupture plane. The movement on the plane leads to a compression by the P wave in this quadrant. It takes place in the direction of movement. Here, this results in a vertical initial displacement of the P wave upwards, that means positive. On the other side of the rupture plane, an expansion or dilatation occurs with downwards displacement, that means negative. Orthogonally to the rupture plane, we can imagine an auxiliary plane such that four quadrants result. Diagonally opposite quadrants have the same orientation as the initial displacement. the position of the second imaginary plane depends directly on the direction of the slip. Both surfaces are called nodal planes. After an earthquake, the seismic waves are now recorded on various seismometers. From the distribution of positive and negative initial displacements, the position of the nodal planes in space can be determined and hence the focal mechanism identified. However, the question of which of these two nodal planes the rupture took place on and which is the imaginary auxiliary plane cannot be determined through seismic observations alone. In order to do this, additional information will need to be considered, for example, geological information such as the previously mentioned orientation of the fault plane or the distribution of aftershocks in seismology. You now know how the orientation of the rupture plane can be determined geologically and seismologically. However, this does not say anything about the magnitude of the earthquake. We will now cover that. In seismology, the dimensions of the rupture plane and the extent of the slip determine the strength, that is, the magnitude of an earthquake. For example, the strongest quake ever measured in Chile in 1960 had a rupture plane measuring 800 km times 200 km with a slip of 21 meters. This corresponds to a magnitude of 9.5. Today, local seismometer networks are able to measure magnitudes far less than zero. A magnitude minus 2 quake, for example, has a rupture plane measuring a good 1 square meter. That is around this big. During the rupture, it slips by less than 1 millimeter. In Germany, a magnitude 4.5 earthquake occurs on average once a year. That corresponds to an approximately 4 centimeter slip on a fault plane of 4 square kilometers. Such an earthquake could also have occurred here. As you can see, the fault zone continues on the other side of the extraction area. Hence, there would have been enough space. However, it is more likely that the 4 meter slip, which is present here, was caused by many small earthquakes or even gradual slippage. You have seen here in the quarry what fault zones look like in nature. Apart from the reverse fault slip in the quarry, a distinction is made between normal faults and strike slip faults. You've learned how the orientation of a rupture plane and the direction of movement of the rock sections describe an earthquake. For this purpose, the parameters strike, dip, and slip are used. You have become acquainted with seismological procedures which utilize the records from many seismometers in order to determine the focal mechanism. Focal mechanisms describe the source for both large and small earthquakes. On the one hand, they are important for understanding large-scale tectonic processes, for example at plate boundaries. On the other, they allow to investigate small-scale events caused by anthropogenic interventions underground.